you save your time, so I would like to start now.
Yep.
He will get in when this preparation is finished. I'm General Yamaguchi. I would like to know the very, very general answers from you. So we have learned from you that you're going to Myanmar in coming March.
Yep.
So what purpose of your trip? Please just tell us it as you can. Just generally, we don't need specifically. And then what kind of opportunity you seeing for future military ties between Japan and Myanmar, because Japan and Myanmar have very long history for military situation.
I'm at National Defense Academy, which is perhaps Myanmar's military academy equivalent. We teach cadets, and we have been doing a lot of exchange programs with foreign military academies. Naval Academy, and that is one of the convenient tools for the militaries to get accustomed to other militaries. We are going to promote Japan-Myanmar military-to-military contact exchanges, one of the arms would be National Defense Academy. So I want to have kind of general idea about Myanmar military and the education.
You said finding the way for only for Naval Academy cadets from Myanmar, or generally, because in Myanmar is the only one military academy, and then in a third year it's separated to
quite similar to ours. Our Defense Academy teach all the cadets from Army, Navy, Air Force.
Oh, same.
So the same. And the some countries have similar systems, and some countries has separate academies. But my point is education and the perhaps research, the research and studies about the military science or the broader, more broadly, any kind of science or arts within the military organizations. Those organizations are easier to talk to others,
yeah.
Without political commitment.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm looking forward to working with military of Myanmar in the future, particularly because our relations, two things, recent development between international community and the Myanmar is getting very drastically better.
Okay.
And in addition, Japanese have very close kind of feeling towards people in Myanmar. And I have a couple of friends from Myanmar. They have kind of close feeling to us. So we are going to do a good job in the future. And last year, in particular, our foreign minister went to Myanmar,
mm-hmm.
And also our vice minister for defense. He's the highest ranking bureau, defense bureau. He visited Myanmar. He is willing to be eager to promote the relations. But I know, because Myanmar they had long been a kind of close.
Yeah.
So it is not the easy task for military organizations of Myanmar to open up or to go
kind of close mostly to Western
countries,
but with Japan is their kind of special relationship.
Right.
And then Myanmar people never complain like Koreans or Chinese regarding Second World War. And then so that's why very friendly relationship since a long time ago. I think I don't need to worry for it. And then I also graduated from that graduate academy. I can give you a hint.
Oh, great. That is great.
Yeah.
I should interview you.
we had a 4 year course.
Yeah.
You know, every year is academic planning is from first year to third year is 8 months a year. So we have, for example, in first year, the first term for academic years, no military training. Academic first term is about 4 months, and then another 4 months is second term. But the rest of 3 months is military training.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 1 month is school holidays. You have to go back home for about 1 month. So every 8 months is academic. Yeah, we have to learn a physics, chemistry, math, and then not only science subjects, also history, economics, you know, military history, and then international relations,
mm-hmm.
this kind of situation. But in final year, academic is shorter, only about 4 months, and then 7 months is military training.
I see.
Yeah, this kind of situation. And then at third year, you know, according to your choice, you apply, I want to join Navy, I want to Air Force. So at that time, you know, the Air Force General and then Naval General, Naval Admiral, they come and make interview and then they choose. This kind of system
is
still
where
there.
Where is that? Is the what year?
Third year.
Third year.
Yeah.
Third year. So fourth, training in the fourth year, last year, is service specific.
No, last year is still all the same for
wow.
basic army military training until platoon commander level. So first year is like a private level, and then second year is section leader,
mm-hmm.
and then third year is a platoon sergeant, and then final year is a platoon commander. But after that, we have to separate, you know, going to army, going to.
So you receive additional training for naval officers.
Yeah.
Okay.
So after that, Air Force pilot to join the Air Force pilot school for another maybe nearly 2 years. For us, also about 16 months to join the Naval Academy again.
So in a sense, similar to ours. In our case, you know, unlike U.S. military, Air Force Naval Academy, they got commissioned upon graduation.
Yeah.
But in our case, after graduation of from the academy, we go, we send our cadets to officer candidate school for more professional training in Navy, Air Force, and Army.
Yeah.
Then one year later, we commission them.
Mm-hmm. So the basic idea is that every military officer, you know, Army or Navy or Air Force, must have at least platoon commander training, because Mama is, you know, counterinsurgencies. And at that time, when I joined the military academy in 1975, it's heavily fighting with the Burma Communist Party forces backed by Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why every young officer must have army training.
Right.
So that's a basic idea at the time. But now they a little bit change. Every cadets in the military academy also now major subjects. So you are going to computer science, you are going to physics, you are going to chemistry.
You have majors?
And now they did
have,
that way. So just hints for you.
Maybe a little bit
you emphasize you want to observe the education for officer cadets. And then another thing is today your workshop is also related to disaster relief operations and civil and military cooperation, something like that. So you know that Cobra Gold military exercise. So Myanmar military eagerly want to join that exercise.
Mm-hmm.
What I learned, it is they now emphasize to join only that part, not the whole part, that disaster overtaking.
Wow.
So the host country is Thailand, and they also directly talk with US military. So before, they try to talk through Thai military.
Mm-hmm.
So, but now U.S. accept for observer's status.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh,
so
good for you.
Yeah, I think.
Right.
So Japan also
yes,
set a cobra goal, but only few.
Yeah, a few observers perhaps. Right?
Yeah.
Observers?
I think
it's small part the participating,
small part, yeah.
Right?
Singapore,
but it's not,
and
it's,
then,
it's not all. It's a quite new initiative.
But the biggest force is the US and Thai forces. So I guess you have to also discuss about this situation, cobra goal, military exercise during your trip or something like that.
I have never been in cobra goal or multilateral exercise. But nowadays, our army and ground self-defense forces are becoming more and more involved in the multilateral exercises.
Mm-hmm. How about the Japanese peacekeeping troop situation? The last we saw is in Afghanistan, right? And only few. And also in Bosnia, before Cambodia.
No, we haven't sent any troops to Afghanistan. But no troops, but some civilian the people helping the governance of Afghanistan, and some NGOs are there to deal with the unexploded munition or landmines.
So it was last time in Bosnia or Cambodia?
We are now withdrawing our troops from the Golan Heights.
Syria.
Is the longest by Syria.
Ah.
And then we have troops in the peacekeepers in South Sudan.
It's an engineering
unit.
Just separated from Sudan last year.
Right. And we send peacekeepers and disaster responders to Haiti.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And also we have done operations in East Timor.
East Timor.
Yeah. And our experience is not old. First time was 1992 when
Cambodia.
We sent Cambodia,
yeah.
Right.
Mr. Akashi at the time?
Yeah, Mr. Akashi was the head of
he's the chief of the... Mm-hmm. And then, so what kind of relationship you expect, after your trip, between Myanmar and Japan, or military rule?
I think, in general, we may have to promote military-to-military contact to deepen mutual understanding, and the it's my personal feeling that because of Japanese very close feeling
in
Myanmar, we might be in assistance for Myanmar government and non-government entities to become more internationalized.
So last year, in the end of August, I got a chance to interview Myanmar president in New York. So when he came Myanmar president, he used to be army general.
Yep.
So I also asked about Myanmar military, because the country is opening up, and then how about military? So what he said to me is Myanmar military is still not standard army yet. So we want to learn from every country, from every military, who will provide us military training or whatever. That's what he said to me.
Okay.
So, and then that you also told me about that officer cadets to be trained in Japan. So do you also have any concerns because of military relationship between and Japan, as some will point out, long time ago history, blah blah blah. But these are from some opponents or some destructive elements can point out. So, Yeah, have you also a preparation how to protect?
Yeah, of course, we have to be careful enough to promoting our relations. And also, I suspect, because of the close nature of the Myanmar, that was Western country,
mm-hmm.
and I feel like Myanmar military may take time to materialize the programs, for instance, exchange cadets or the sending cadets to our National Defense Academy. And that, because of my experience, when I was young, the Japanese SDF are not open. And the training with the Americans, we became more and more open in the late 70s, 80s, as well.
So even after Japan got back to Okinawa, so after 1970s,
And also, bureaucracy.
Mm-hmm.
Every military has, very very conservative bureaucracy. So it's not easy to start new kinds of business. So and that is I can tell you from my experience. So I'm not in a hurry, but and I don't want to push my company. But I can tell you that we have almost 20 more than 20 foreign cadets spending 5 years, 1 year Japanese language training, and rest the 4 years for the university level, the academic education, in addition to extra. Not as high as platoon leader, but more basic. Right?
That's what I want to talk with you, because for Myanmar military, sending just high school graduates, about 16, 17, 18, to other country for officer grade training is maybe very, very, very first time. But Myanmar military used to send higher level military officer course to several countries, I think except Japan. And then when Myanmar achieved the independence from British, so British and Myanmar has still some kind of bond for military relationship. So after 1948, Burma achieved independence, the Burma military officers were mostly sent to England. And then at the time also, some kind of officer cadets are sending to St. Louis, and for naval cadets is sending to Dartmouth, so that kind of situation.
Mm-hmm.
But later, mostly the higher level and kind of tactical commander course or more higher level course, mostly to United States until 1988.
Mm-hmm.
So do you also have consideration for higher level officer training from Myanmar military?
There are possibilities. And having that, we have a National Institute for Defense Studies for the higher education, maybe highest education for mainly colonels and captains, promising, those of the most promising ones.
Mm-hmm.
We teach strategy, international politics, situation, international environment for 1 year,
mm-hmm.
and for which we accept foreign students from a number of countries, including China.
Oh,
and that is one possibility. Of course, our staff colleges in Army, just staff, and Maritime Self-Defense Force, as well as Grand Self-Defense Forces, all the services have staff colleges. They have captain major, staff education, and the lieutenant colonel higher education. those are the service education. But my academy has, you know, cadet education, young cadets, we educate them. And also we have graduate schools in both engineering science and the social science.
Further studies.
Right.
Yeah.
We accept a number of students from Vietnam, Thailand, number of the Philippines in the graduate course, mainly engineering and science. They want to have educated engineers or scientists.
Academic.
And the, you know, perhaps designing weapons or dealing with technology. And also we have students from foreign countries for master and doctor education in the international relations or security studies.
So Burma also created a National Defense College, NDC. But used to be NDC long time ago, but last 15 years ago, the new system of the NDC is the colonel level, who have to be promoted to brigadier general, must attend, you know. It's a kind of big competition, you know, for colonels to join the NDC, and it is 2 years course.
2 years old.
2 years, and then after you accomplish that mission, you will have a master's degree. Master of Arts for Defense. So in Myanmar, you will see all brigadier general and above level, they all have Master of Arts for Defense from that school. So
yeah,
you might also
right.
see. And you might also meet the Commander in Chief, I think now Vice Senior General Me Aung Hlaing, who is a 1 year senior of me. And then number three guy is a Chief of Staff. It's my classmate, General Lark Havens, and you might also see. So they all graduated from that postgrad school. That's why they have MA. But I think because they cannot send to other country and sanctions, even they have a relationship and they just send to senior military level, training level to Pakistan, Malaysia, that's all. But they want to send, you know, like a more sophisticated country, but they don't have chance. Now I think if Japan is that, they will have a chance.
And what about the language training in the academy?
Language training, they at first, you know, for English, about 6 months. And they sent to Russia a lot before, so these young guy have also to study Russian language about 1 year in the another camp, something like that. But it doesn't work in Russia because of Russia just accept and they send you the, like on the road you can see like a Nihongo-kakko, that kind of school only. They cannot really join the Russian military school.
We do have short-term kind of exchange programs. They're accepting cadets from various countries for week or 10 days to just experience life in
discussion.
And also we have an international cadet conference. It is done in English, inviting the, you know, many countries' cadets to discuss common issues, but they are very smart. And nowadays Japanese cadets are much better in terms of language than my age.
You are time.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. This just what I want to know.
So
from
my guess is if the Myanmar's military academy has good English speaker or educate some English ability and to present or to join the our cadets along with other cadets in discussion for 3 days or 4 days. That would be an opportunity and a choice.
See. For Myanmar, you know, Myanmar used to be British colony,
yeah.
So our education system is we have to learn English since kindergarten.
Oh,
so
right.
Yeah, so
much better than ours.
yeah, that's why reading and writing is no problem for them, but they don't have experience for practicing, they do, for speaking. Even for me, I can only speak English when I came to Japan, because inside the country, I don't have chance to speak English. So I think it may be
yeah.
okay, and then so you don't need to worry for it.
Okay, great.
Yeah, and then well, what more about now? I will move to another topic, not related to Myanmar military, but so before moving, what do you want to tell me about more? You related to Myanmar military and then your trip, you know.
No, I want to have a first-hand kind of experience for the future bilateral relations with Myanmar. Then I have to think about what kinds of policies or what kinds of programs can be options. And the, of course, we need to wait for the political decision from the top level. But I'm quite optimistic about that within the next couple of years, we may have some kind of positive policy development in terms of dealing with Myanmar military. And this is actually the in the general course of Japanese policy.
Yeah.
If you look at the National Defense Program guidelines adopted in 2010, the cooperation with other countries for security for the region is one of the key pillars for the security. Of course, we do our own, Japan's own defense effort for security, and we do the another tier is another level. The next level is bilateral, bilateral efforts with the United States as an ally.
Mm.
And third level is the cooperation with the regional countries.
In the region,
right. And the fourth level is in any country
yeah.
in the world.
Yeah. So that's a policy of defense. So
right, the broadening
yeah.
the
so
cooperation.
For political arena, whoever rule, I mean, LDP or DPG or Jimindo or Mishido, whoever rule, this the policy
that
of the country.
That's what I believe.
Yeah, so that's what it's a very connected to my next question. So now, what is Japan's role in Asia Pacific region security? Now, United States. They withdraw from Middle East, from Afghanistan, Iraq, and now they emphasize more in the Asia, especially East Asia. East Asia meaning including Southeast Asia, and then nowadays the most hot area is Japan and Korea and China, this area. So in this kind of situation, Japan's role is now before Japanese military is only the agency level and a self-defense force, IJ. You have a maritime self-defense force, air self-defense force, and then ground self-defense force, so this kind of situation. But now you have the wider and bigger organization and become a ministry level. So
not necessarily bigger, but no, name is a little bit different from the past one.
But how about the budget?
Budget is... I'm hoping, LDP, new administration, increase. No, in the last 10, more than 10 years, our budget was
yeah,
going down,
very low.
Very
yeah.
low. Actually, steady,
mm-hmm.
steadily low. It's almost the time to take off.
Yeah.
It's a good news,
mm-hmm.
and but not big difference.
Yeah. In this South China Sea situation, so when we look at South China Sea, the northern part is very important for Japan, and then southern part connected to Indonesia, Malaysia is Australia thing. It is its responsibility. So So how about Japan? And do you also have another policy? You know, how to defend, you know, Japan Sea, west of Japan, and then that South China Sea. Now you have one and two. You have two dispute with you know, in that area. One with Korea, South Korea. One with China. This kind of maritime territory disputes. You know, what kind of rule Japan is thinking? You know, you cannot rely on United States all the time, and the United States also cannot take responsibility, you know, all of the time. So what Japan think for it?
Yeah, you know, the first of all, territorial disputes, whatever it means, should be dealt with in with a peaceful means,
yeah,
so by diplomatic. So I'm hoping, things between Japan and Korea, Japan, China, getting calm in the near future. And meanwhile, to make sure that the U.S. is with us, Japan should be determined to protect ourselves. Otherwise, they may not help us.
Yeah.
So our determination is a key.
Mm-hmm.
Then the U.S. might be willing to help us.
Mm-hmm.
When, after 3/11, East Japan Great Earthquake, Japanese were really serious about helping the people, suffering people.
Mm-hmm.
Having seen that seriousness, U.S. Became more serious about
the Tohoku,
yeah.
Tohoku,
right.
Yeah, tsunami earthquake.
And we have to show our determination to defend ourselves by making the better shape of
mm-hmm.
self defense forces, and budget increase may be the kind of signal for that purpose too. And also we have to try our best to make the regional situation calm,
mm-hmm.
and particularly if you look at the China's rights,
yeah.
We have to create or develop constructive relations with China.
Yeah.
So we have to work with Chinese too for the better relations between China and other countries.
Mm-hmm.
We are not living in a Cold War.
Yeah.
And that's I like the phrase made by Madam Clinton last year.
Hillary Clinton
went to Naval Academy early April, and gave a very wonderful speech.
Japanese Naval Academy.
Right. Yeah, no. The U.S. Naval Academy.
Annapolis.
Right.
Yeah.
And she was telling that current geopolitics.
Mm-hmm.
Geopolitics today cannot afford to be a zero-sum game.
Mm.
It must be plus-sum game.
Yeah.
And in addition, what she said is a thriving China is good for America,
mm-hmm.
and a thriving America is good for China.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a plus-sum.
Mm.
But zero-sum, it's not a zero-sum game.
Yeah.
But
zero-sum game is in
Cold War.
Mm-hmm.
But it implies me that if we fail to make it plus some, it is going to minus some.
Yeah.
Everybody is going to lose.
Yeah.
So we have to avoid that kind of situation. So the having a positive and constructive relations with China and other countries in the region is key for Japan's security.
Do you also think that China also have this kind of concept?
Chinese friends have kept telling me, don't be in the kind of Cold War thinker.
And then how about North Korea?
North Korea, yes.
You cannot predict.
Yeah, that's right.
What will we do?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
We have to keep watching what
mm-hmm.
is happening.
Do you also think Japan has enough defense? situation, you know, for North Korea aggression or some kind of, you know, they are doing so strange things like trying to launch missile, you know, pass through Japan, this kind of thing.
No, it's fortunate for us to see the situation where we have been working really hard to develop our anti-ballistic missile defense capabilities.
Like a
Patriot and Aegis destroyers. And when you know, they launched missile twice last year.
They put down two or something.
Right. And in both cases, we deployed our Patriot batteries to the some of the islands.
Yeah. Even in Tokyo, right? We saw
in
the photos.
And also, we sent Aegis destroyers to watch, you know, incoming missiles. That is you know, government responsibility to do best, to do its best to protect the population.
And then few years ago, and then Japan, I think it's a ruling parties in Shiko DPJ. So at that time, Japan and, you know, alliance that US has a kind of, you know, big disputes for
ups and downs.
Yeah.
Ups and downs.
Now that
now it's in a better shape.
Better shape.
And even during the DPJ administration, at the latter half, it became much better, and it did a lot of good thing.
So at that time, it said that the Futenma, that they have to move to Guam, or and then Japan have to also spend all expenses for that moving or something like that. So these situations are. Now I think now you two are already aligned, so already solved that dispute. So
it's a long story, but if you look at the U.S. rebalance toward the Asia Pacific region, the U.S. is the going toward the kind of peacetime posture, as opposed to wartime mobilized posture to fight two wars in Afghanistan and
Iraq.
And if you look at Marines alone, they have maybe 10,000 Marines in Hawaii, and less than, a little bit less than 20,000 Marines in Okinawa, and some in Iwakuni.
Iwakuni.
Right. So those are the places northern Pacific, and what they are doing is to move some Marines to Guam. And some Marines to Darwin in Australia.
Northern Territory.
Right.
Yeah.
So then that means U.S. is more, U.S. Marines are going to be in a
more deployment.
Right, deployment. And small. Each piece may be smaller than the one in Okinawa currently deployed. But the smaller forces are Okinawa, Guam, Hawaii, and
Darwin.
To do good thing.
Yeah, not mobilizing.
Right.
Yeah. You see, so
we are helping that movement.
Yeah.
And we are obliged to do so, based on agreement with the United States. So in return, we will have some U.S. bases in Okinawa return. Particularly those in the southern part of Okinawa, which is the most populated area. And so, those returning bases may help Okinawan, Okinawan economy.
Mm-hmm.
It's the most urban area.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm kind of hopeful to see better shape in Okinawa.
Okay. And then U.S. is always thinking of the bottom of the Asia Pacific security is only on United States and Japan, and what about Australia? So now they want to bring Australia, you know, into the ring, and Australia also eagerly want to jump in. That's what we think, but I'm not sure.
I have no idea about that.
So that's what I want to know. What about Japan is thinking for Australia also, you know, involving more and more Asia Pacific security in bigger role? I mean, this side, but the other side, like our country in the Indian Ocean side, there the Indian Navy is also very big. So, I mean, this side, the east side, so Australia want to involve more for military activities. So, for it, Japan also, what I think it is good for, or you know, it is kind of rival for you, or what do you think?
I think there's a big room for Australians and Japanese to work together for better security situations. The maritime is one, and proliferation security initiative to avoid materials for rocket missiles or nuclear weapons going to other areas or countries to make them nuclear armed. So that kind of things we need to avoid. And in that sense, North Korea is one of the most cooperative countries.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a big room, and also Australia, Japan, Australia is next to the United States in terms of security cooperation.
Yeah.
So, and the next was supposed to be Korea, but last year we had problem. We had to postpone the kind of agreement. But
South Korea.
In South Korea, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, we are looking for cooperation with the regional nations.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, including China.
Yeah. So what do you want to tell me more, you know, related to that, Japan's role in Asia-Pacific security? So from me, is my question are enough.
Yeah.
So what do you want to tell more besides mine?
Yeah, I think related to the your last question, because of the past history that we went to Southeast Asia,
mm-hmm.
and China in the 1930s, and we have the clear memory about that, and we know what was wrong, and also we know how our neighbors
mm-hmm.
feel about Japanese military activities. So we have been really careful about doing things, and we will have to keep being careful.
Mm-hmm.
And in that sense, softer part of military cooperation, like disaster relief or humanitarian assistance,
mm-hmm.
or preventing proliferation.
Mm-hmm.
Those kinds of areas are going to be, hopeful areas for us to promote our cooperation with regional countries, including Myanmar.
Thank you very much, General.
Thank you
for spending your time for me.
Thank you very
Thanks
much.
A lot.
You're welcome.
Can I take one photo?